turn. Worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb. You are holy.
Didn't know today would be your last, or that I'd have to say goodbye to you so fast. I'm so numb I can't feel anymore. I'm praying you just walk back through that door and tell me that I was only dreaming. You're not really gone as long as I believe. There will be another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight. Always made my troubles feel so small.
We want to thank you for being here this afternoon. We are here for a celebration life service of Jim Babcock. Everyone who's here probably is a friend of Jim in some way, or Gina. And I've really been encouraged over the last 2 hours just to watch people come in and stand and talk and share memories and laugh and shed some tears. And that's what a celebration of life is all about. We have lost a good friend, a brother in Christ, a fellow co-worker, And Jim just has impacted our lives in many, many ways. And that's what we want to talk about during the service today. So as we begin, let's start with a prayer, okay? Father, thank you. Thank you for allowing us to be here. Thank you for Jim Babcock. Thank you for his life, his example, his friendship, Lord, his work ethic. Thank you for his marriage, his family. And Father, we hate to give anybody up, but what we understand is that our life's a journey and then we go home. So we are truly, truly grateful for that. And Father, we ask you that that we will glorify you and praise you and lift you up during this time of service. That's what Jim would want, and that's what you want from us, and that's what we want to do. And Father, we pray that as we share some examples from the scriptures and from Jim's life, help it to draw closer to you. And Father, if there's somebody here today, Jim would want that person. That person is not close to you, it would be Jim's encouragement to think about your relationship with our risen Savior. Thank you for Jesus. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
One of the requests that Jim had was congregational singing, and congregational singing meant a lot to him when he was through this journey these last several weeks. At every moment he could be there, he came to experience worship. Came here on Sundays. We had a college student and youth group singing night, and he came to that over at the UCSC. And our praise team got to go to his house and got to sing with him. And he had one very specific request for all the songs that we sang. He only wanted praise songs. He didn't want sad songs. He wanted praise songs. So we're going to honor that today as well. We're going to sing praise songs. But it's going to be a little different. So I'm going to prepare you for the moment right now. The first song we're going to sing is Straight Up. We're singing it together. The next two songs we're going to sing are actually going to be songs on video of our praise team with Jim singing. Gina filmed it. We didn't know when she filmed it we were going to use it today. But you'll see him on the screen singing, and we're going to sing with him. So watch and sing along for the next two songs after this one. But the first one, we're going to just sing straight up. No Tears in Heaven. It's a very appropriate praise song to begin a service like this. So let's all sing together.
No tears in heaven, no sorrow given, all will be glory in that land. There'll be no sadness, all will be gladness, when we shall join that happy band. No tears, no tears, no tears up there, sorrow and pain will all have flown. No tears, no tears, no tears up there. No tears in heaven will be known. Glory is waiting, waiting up yonder, where we shall spend an endless day. There with our Savior will be forever, where no more sorrow can dismay. No tears, no tears, no tears up there, sorrow and pain will. Some morning yonder we'll cease to ponder o'er things this life has brought to view. All will be clearer, saved ones be dearer, in heaven where all will be made new. No tears, no tears.
Hello. My name is Amy Phillips, and I am the clinical manager at Coolville Regional Home Health. I have had the honor of working with Jim for 7 years. If you know Jim, you know there was no quick in his vocabulary. He was never in a hurry. I recall one time I made a visit with him where I observed Jim with his patient, taking his time, listening, showing compassion and concern, and again, in no hurry. It was at that time I realized Jim was Jim, and it was about his caring character, his meticulous charting, and more importantly, the quality of care that he provided, not his speed. He never wanted to let his work family down. He even worked the weekend that he got his diagnosis, barely making it to see his visits that day. He was a team player, always looking out for his coworkers. He never complained about doing extra. He would most always say yes. He was our go-to person for everything, including putting air in tires, making sure we were safe getting to our car, and hanging pictures on the wall, you name it. For the first several weeks following his diagnosis, he got to live the quality of life he had hoped for. It was a remarkable time for his home health family to get to witness and hear about his unwavering faith, his induction into the Nursing Honor Guard, the church gathering at his home for singing and worship, and the friends that came to visit far and wide. We were so amazed at his spirit. He was consoling us, his home health family, as we all had a hard time with this. Thank you, Gina, for allowing us to be on this journey with you. I would now like to try to get through a poem written by Sherry Maynard. This is Jim. This is Jim, his home health family has often heard him say, as he called his patients to begin his day. I'm scheduled to see you to start your home health care. Then he'd be silent for a minute or two, and then simply reply, whatever time works best for you. He would continue with, is there anything I should be on the lookout for, such as large dogs, big snakes, or a pet alligator? This statement alone brought smiles to those of us who heard that question asked. To establish a rapport with the patient before he even met them for Jim was an easy task. He would schedule which patients needed to be seen first and who was okay to be seen last. He wouldn't get in a hurry. He wasn't known to be fast. But diligent, thorough, patient, and kind, the desire to serve others always first on his mind. Many days he ended up with more patients than he had planned to see, wanting to help ease a coworker's schedule or see an additional patient in need. Jim fulfilled several roles, wearing many different hats, literally, as a matter of fact, from his paperboy cap to his exceptional bean baseball hat. As a husband to his wife, Gina, his love and devotion was evident day after day, sharing life's journey together, as she was his favorite, he would always say. He was a friend to all, exemplifying God's mercy, grace, encouragement, loyalty, rare qualities to find in today's society. And as a father, grandfather, son, and brother, he cherished every moment that he got to share with each other. To Jim, sharing the gospel of his Lord Jesus was his ultimate goal, which he accomplished through all of his multiple roles. As a missionary, a minister, a physical and spiritual comfort as a registered nurse, Jim entered the gates of glory with the words from Jesus' parable in Matthew 25, the 23rd verse. Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of the Lord. As his faith never wavered, his light never grew dim. He heard Jesus say to all of heaven, I know you personally. Hey, everyone, this is Jim. Thank you.
When peace is like a river ascending down my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my life.
About Jim's illness, and he came home with hospice care. Told Gina, and we're all in a small group together, about 10 or 12 of us, more maybe. And I said, Gina, just tell us, let's find out what Jim wants to do. And that song made me think that the following Sunday, she called, or the following week, she said, he wants to come to church. I said, you are kidding me. And so I went over to the Blue Roof, and they loaned us a chair, a special chair, and we had two of our guys waiting for them as they came in the door, and we wanted him to be comfortable. And we set him in the back right corner, and that was not their regular spot. And but he, they rolled, after the service was up, we just told people, Jim's here. And after the services, we're going to take him up to the front, and anybody wants to visit with him. And I finally had to leave. There were so many people lined up to visit with you guys and encourage you and love on you. And that's the impact that y'all have made on our family. So a few days go by, and all at once I understand there's a Teenside UCSC, that's our college students, there's a singing on Wednesday night. Jim wants to go, and I'm thinking, he's getting weaker. I just know he is. And brought him over, got him in the chair, rode him up a long ramp, and he sang. And people would turn, because you all know Jim had a strong voice, didn't he? He just did. I think he may have gone to a late night praise one night because he wanted to keep singing and praising God. And he came back to one more service. And I would remember people, we would sit in that back right corner, and not everybody knew him back then, but they would walk out and say, who was that guy? He can out-sing all of us. And that was Jim Babcock. He was going to praise God to the end. And in our talks together, in the last several weeks when we would visit with him, we got to talking about our prayer lives, and what we asked for. And of course, we all pray for healing, don't we? And Jim just basically said, Mike, this is a win-win prayer. I'm going to win either way. I'll be here a little bit longer. I'm just going to go on home. And so God answered the prayer. And we're the ones who are hurting so much. But I think that song, just to think about him participating to the very, very end. Peggy and I got to know Jim and Gina when they identified with our church family for the last several years in the same small group. And I became very impressed with Jim because when he got here, we only had one set of doors that y'all walked through. Two sets, we only had one set. And one morning, about 45 minutes before anybody walked in, Peg and I drove up, and Jim was standing out there, and Jim became our official welcomer. at College Side. And he was there every Sunday morning when it got cold. He always had a hat on because, you know, he wanted to protect his head. You know, he didn't have as much hair as some of us did. And I would tease him about that. And I can remember after COVID and we had closed down for a little while and opened back up, Jim and Gina were trying to be a little bit more careful because of their type of work. And so I became a greeter. You know, I knew I wasn't going to be Jim, but we would greet. And one morning, a little lady walked up, a little sister of ours walked up. I said, "Hey, how are you doing?" She said, "I'm good. Where's Jim Babcock?" You know, with that friendly pat on the back, you know, I continued to stay as a greeter. Jim and I were fellow missionaries. He was in Kenya. Peggy and I, we were in Brazil for 5 years. So we had things to talk about through the years. Somehow, we started playing disc golf together. And I think you're right. I think Jim even walked slowly, but on the disc golf course, he would outwalk me so much quicker. He just loved playing, you know, when we would get together and play disc golf. Jim, it's already been said, and it's going to be said again, I'm sure, Jim was an example of a servant of Jesus. When I think about Jesus teaching his disciples about washing feet, meaning we need to serve one another. And it was said in the prayer and in your story, and I appreciate those words so much. That's what I would see in Jim when he was here. That's what I recognized he did in the community where you served with people who needed help, needed medical help. Jim was just available. And he would come in late sometimes to our meeting. Sometimes he didn't show up. And there was always a reason. Jim was helping somebody. Jim was washing someone's feet. Let me read something to you quickly. This was written by Gina. And this basically is another "This is Jim" story. But I thought her words were just so Jimish. And I want to read that to you. Jimmy Doyce Babcock was born April the 10th, 1958 in Temple, Texas. He was the youngest son of three, born to Foy and Dorothy Babcock. Jim spent his early years in Odessa, Texas, before the family moved to the small town of Bogota, Texas, where Jim went to high school. He spent summers helping his mother can vegetables. He enjoyed working with surrounding farmers and ranchers. He hauled hay, pulled calves, and actually began his medical career there. His first medical patient was a cow that was paralyzed giving birth. When the rancher started to put the cow down, Jim intervened, asking if he could take her and work with her, and Jim and his parents began intense physical therapy with the cow. She eventually made it onto her own 4 feet and proceeded to walk and eat a small tree Jim's mother had just planted. The grateful cow worked off her medical bill by providing them with 2 calves to sell and help produce butter and milk they sold to the neighbors. After high school, Jim briefly pursued mechanical engineering as a career. Jim found that did not satisfy his deep longing to serve. He began school at White's Ferry Road School of Preaching and eventually finished his bachelor's degree in Bible at Abilene Christian. Jim moved his family to the mission field in Africa. They began service in Uganda, and after only 6 months there, they had to move because they would not pay bribes to immigration. They left only a few believers. Jim later found out that with the help of the team that followed them, those few believers grew to over 100 churches. This was the first example of many in Jim's life when he could look back and see that God's plan was greater than his own. The young family relocated to Kenya, where Ariel was born. The family had to relocate to the States suddenly. Jim had just begun several individual studies with people and worried that leaving would hinder their spiritual growth. He returned on a visit to Kenya 15 years later to discover that one of those individuals, Mama Monica, had been instrumental in establishing a thriving church that grew from the studies that he began. Upon returning to the States, Jim realized when visiting the sick, he felt rather envious of the nurses that tended to them. He was intrigued by the idea of providing physical assistance and comfort rather than only spiritual conduct or comfort. When the opportunity presented itself, he attended nursing school. He loved being a nurse. He loved caring for others. Dr. Jet Gentry recently told Jim during a visit, "When my patients had you as a nurse, I always knew that they were loved. They would come into my office and talk about you like you were their best friend." He loved the camaraderie with his fellow caregivers. He loved being part of a team, and oh, how his teammates stepped up to serve him and Gina in their time of need. The love and support his co-workers have shown has been nothing short of astounding. It was while working in the local hospital that Jim met Gina. They married in May of 2007. They built their lives around each other in service towards others. They enjoyed traveling, but were also content to be at home watching TV, playing with their dog. Among the things Gina will miss about Jim is his boundless knowledge of random facts. For example, the type of horse Genghis Khan rode. Everybody knows that, don't they? Are the best time to eat oranges in Barcelona. And he's never been to Barcelona. You pick a topic, chances are good Jim knew something about it, and if he didn't, he was eager to learn. Jim was willing to tackle any home project Gina could dream up, and he would stand fearlessly between her and any bugs that might show up. I wish you could see the bug-killing machines he had in his house. It was unreal. He loved her so well. Even the hard times were easy because he made them easy. In addition to Gina, Jim leaves behind his two children, Daniel and Ariel. Jim was a devoted and loving father. He was proud to be a babu to Ember and Parker. He cherished every moment he had with them. He survived by his mother, Dorothy, and two brothers, Alan and Larry. Jim made friends so easily. He survived by countless friends all over the world. Jim's life was characterized by his faith, by his total reliance on God's grace and mercy. Jim left this world on March 21st to begin his eternal life with the Lord and Savior. Those of us left behind are better simply to have known him. And I think the word better is so important for us today. When we go home, we're going to be better, aren't we? We just will. So thank you for writing those words and sharing that with us.
Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet he shall live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is coming into the world." Jesus heard about the death of his friend, Lazarus. The story tells us that Lazarus has been in the tomb for 4 days. Jews believed that the soul stayed with a person for 3 days. Jesus waits until the fourth day to prove a point, to prove that Lazarus is really dead. Martha, whom Jesus loves, rushes to him. She runs to him before he even gets to town and tells him, if you had been here, you could have prevented this. Jesus says that he'll rise again. Martha tells Jesus, "I know that you are the resurrection. I know the resurrection is real." And Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life." It's an interesting story and an interesting response that Jesus gives to the lady. Because on some level, she has faith. She comes to Jesus and she says, "I believe something." Jesus challenges her gently. Jesus says, "Do you believe?" She says, "Yes, Lord. You are God's Son. And someday, you'll have the power." And there in that story lies the difference between the way most people see Jesus and the way that believers, like Jim, see Jesus. See, it's not just that Jesus will have power someday, it's that Jesus has power today. And Jim believed this. Yes, Lord, you are the Son, and someday, there's faith, Jesus pushes more. He has a similar interaction with her sister, Mary. She weeps too. This is a funeral. There are tears. Real tears. Jesus himself, in the 35th verse, the gospel writer records, weeps as well. Verse 33, when Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in his spirit and greatly troubled. And he said, "Where have you laid him? Where's Lazarus?"